outlook of coal in the post-COVID scenario. So I welcome all participants after the inaugural session. I know we are late by 10-15 minutes, though in the first inaugural session, it was attended a lot of participants. And we heard the our chief guest, the Hansukh Mandaviya ji, shipping minister, and also the CMD of Hindustan Zinc also, Hindustan Copper. So we heard both of them. It was great insight from them that government is doing good in the shipping, in the automation. At this entire 3 days, working on the automation, in the digitalization. And this topic, we are going to have a panel discussion on the coal future, especially in the COVID scenario. Though we are not having a transformation in the digitalization in the topic, but we'll, in the end, we'll have a touch upon the digitalization part. I know he is himself a chartered accountant and knows about more the digitalization, and we'll look something hearing from him. I wanted to introduce all the panelists. Rajesh Somani ji, as I said, he's a chartered accountant. He's a managing director and CEO of the Swift Singapore Pte. Limited, and handling the entire trade of this company, and associated from the Adit Birla Group since ages, and reached to the height to the particular level. Hardly I have seen the chartered accountant reaching to the top managing director level post in the commodity segment, which is the rarest, and will have to listen him, you know, how they reach and what the commodity is perceived, because the participants in this conference are 50% are commodity side and 50% are, you know, chartered accountant as well. And we have more than 2,800 people are seeing this conference on our platform and in the social media platform also. And we have the another speaker, Atisa. Atit is also a person who is also director in the Karawal Group, handling the coal. And Karawal is known for the entire in the coal segment. And previously he worked in Adani, and he's where he started is the coal trading business. And now he's in heading the Singapore. Previously to that in the Karawal, he had also the Dutch bank trading desk in 2010. So welcome Atit for this panelist. We have Devendra Agarwal ji. Devendra Agarwal ji is our director and board member in the Mohit Mindal, a very well-known company. And previously he works in the L&T, handled various projects, and he was also Nabha Power Limited, Punjab, where he handled two power plant of 700 megawatt. So I'll welcome Devendra Agarwal ji to this conference. And also we have the Deepak Kannan ji. Deepak, director, Asia Thermal S&P Global Platts, which is very known to all trading community and for the Platts. And we always waiting for the, in the trading community, we wait for the Platts in index. So what the index, every Friday, 4 o'clock, we always look for, you know, what the Platts index are coming. So every people, those on the poll, knows about the Platts and the key insights of the Platts and how authenticated, how perfect the Platts is, very, you know, widely aware of it. Platts in March 12th. And he named MD Asia Pacific Thermal Coal in November 13. So I welcome to all the three panelists over in this segment. So I'll start with this first, my topic to the Rajesh Somani ji. Rajesh Somani ji, he's himself a chartered accountant as well, managing director. So sir, first of all, you know, being a lot of chartered accountants are here also listening to you, just wanted to know, being not in the trading side, never been experienced, and how you chartered accountant reached to this particular label of the post of the head of the Swiss Singapore, those are trading in the coal and more than 3 billion turnover. So can I hear from you, sir?
First of all, Dhirajit, thank you very much for creating this wonderful platform and giving opportunity to all of us that we can share our views and as well as learn from each other. Coming to the point of your being a chartered accountant and reaching to the commodity trading business at CEO level, let me tell you, for all benefit of all, and I have been repeating that, the size of your success or the height of your success is start with your dreams. If your dream size is small, then it took you to that level only. But if your dream is big and you can make your passion and then make your commitment to it with hard work, I think then success will come to your path. And being a chartered accountant, there are two benefits. One is that you are a regular P&L writer. You always write your balance sheet and P&L. You have a good grip on the number. You have good grip on the financial return. So when you can write well, I think you can create well also. So with this spirit, being aspiration to become entrepreneur, I thought that other than routine like auditing, taxes and accounting, if we can create a legacy for the next generation or the professional people, then entrepreneurs should be, and chartered accountant, according to me, is the well equipped. Commodity trading is a function of P&L management and the risk management, where I feel chartered accountant score very high.
So, sir, here I just wanted to outlook on the coal market. I am aware of that, the current governments are working very hard. There's a quite still deficient is there in the consumption as well as the production. So India always depend upon the import. So how much the world currently relies on coal segment, or particularly India, and what is the investment landscape changing to move away from it, and what is the India role in it? What's your thought?
Dhiraj, let me tell you that before 2016, which is the year of Paris Accord, coal was the well-known cheapest energy provider in the world, without any question about it, environmental suitability or the CO2 emission. And even after 2016, today if you ask, there are the two parameters. First, what is the share of coal in overall world energy map? If you look from that point of view, coal is the second largest energy provider in the world, having the 27% market, 27% share, led by oil 33% and followed by gas 24%. So till today also, the coal is one of the major source of energy for the world economy or the world population. Second important aspect is electricity generation. If you go worldwide, the terawatt per hour is about 26,700. And out of that, coal is contributing 38% electricity generation. Followed by the natural gas, which is 25%. And the hydro is again, hydroelectricity is 17%. So from both the angles, whether the total energy on energy map or as well as on electricity generation, coal is still commanding a very, you can say, the indispensable position. Now, coming to that, whether the coal is going to be future assets for the electricity or for the energy, no doubt, today, the maximum uncertainty about the outlook of coal is the highest among the energy. And because of the environmental tag attached with this assets, and rightly so, the CO2 emission also. But if you ask today also, the more than 50% coal consumption is handled by the China alone and consumed by the China, followed by the India. So the seven countries consume about world 80% coal. And if you ask me among the seven countries, they are China, India, USA, Germany, Russia, Japan. Except Germany, it doesn't look any of the other countries planning to get out of this coal consumption. Rather, if you ask me, in the next few years, there is already commitment of more than $20 billion investment and increasing the coal capacity by 500 million ton. Yes, some of the banks and financial institutions have withdrawn out of these assets, considering the environmental commitment. But still today, if you ask me, Asian Development Bank, Asian Infrastructure and Investment Institute, both are financing the coal assets, whether it's a power plant or whether it's a coal mine. So in my opinion, the coal is remain going to be a valuable asset for the energy sector. The challenge before the coal is not from the environment or the air. In my opinion, challenge before coal is likely to come from collapsing power cost, collapsing cost of the power from the renewable energy. If that becomes viable, I can tell you whether you have a Paris Accord or not, the coal is going to be replaced by the economical, environment-friendly assets or the renewable energy. But otherwise, you very well know the U.S. president, when the first won the election and somebody asked him that what about the Paris Accord, then he simply replied that I have been elected to represent the citizen of Petersburg, not the Paris. That was his dialogue. And I can tell you, if the coal assets is likely to continue get support or extra calories from the leader like Trump, this assets is going to be continue at least in our foreseeable future.
It's a big announcement, a big statement from the Rajesh Somani ji, that the India people don't have to worry in after COVID-19 or whether coal going to remain. You have to be faithful on the coal, and you can stay on invested. Now I'll come back to the Atit sir. He's heading the global commodity market. So Atit, what's the future outlook in the global? Because everywhere is we talk about alternate energy, what the price stand, and in this COVID transition period, price has reduced, people have lost the money. So what's your outlook, future outlook, and what do you want to say for globally?
Okay, first of all, I thanks the Trade Report for the for this particular platform to provide and talk, and we can discuss about all this particular issue. Also, I'm very very thankful to the Trade Report for like I'm on the same stage where Somani ji, Arolkar ji is all there, which is like when I joined the industry, I've seen them working there at top level, and then joining with them on the same screen, I think that gives me a lot of kind of a pride in myself that like I'm there. So thanks a lot for that. I think again what I would say that like for the I 100% agree with Somani ji. Yeah, probably like people says that we are coming from the coal industry and that's why we are saying this. But yes and no both. I think the coal is the still the cheapest kind of a fuel. So it's a matter of like all economics. So we start from like see, sir mentioned about the Paris Accord and everything, which is fine. But like if you go back 23 years behind, like 1997, there was a Kyoto Protocol was there. So with the Kyoto Protocol also been done, we have seen that like the global demand of coal has gone down slightly from 97 to 99. But like look at this, once we hit this Asian financial crisis, suddenly all put it aside, nothing done. Just look at the what the economically works well. Coal at that time in 2000 to 2013, in 13 years, exponential growth of the coal industry as such. So like we have seen almost 75% growth between the 13 years, which is not even we have seen in the 9 decades before 2000 in the coal as an industry, right? So I would like to say that like as and when there is a time where we hit some kind of a problem, whether it's a financial crisis in Asian financial crisis or the global financial crisis in 2008, every time there's a bit of dip for 1 or 2 years, like which we have seen in 2008 as well, 2008, 2009. But like you look at the 2010 to 13, again, a big peak on the stuff. So again, we just came like, so 2014, we picked at the highest volumes on the coal globally traded. Then we again came out with this Paris Accord. People like when we are in a good economical condition, people start talking about greenhouse gas and then like kind of a renewables and like clean energy. Yes, we have time and energy and then probably the financial capacity to talk about all those things. But the time like so again, Paris Accord came in 2015. Market gone down, but suddenly like 2016, 17 again, like it started picking up. And now we are again at this top highest kind of a global coal trade is happening even today. I'm talking about like 2019, 2020. So let's see this again. We see this COVID is being as a kind of an event, right? So yes, we definitely struggling a lot due to COVID across the globe. India is definitely one of the place where like we are very, very concerned because of the COVID and all. But like, let's see, look at this last 1 month. Again, I'm like being super micro at the moment rather than going into like too big a picture. So China started buying left, right, and center in terms of all infrastructure products, right? So they are like importing everything big on iron ore, on a coal. Market started moving up. And I see the same sense what I've seen in like after a few crises that like the commodity boom is just there, right? So like we are just about to restart this commodity boom. Again, I'm not saying that it's going to last like the way we've seen in 2000, 2013. But yes, we may see a shorter cycles of like boom and then coming down. So I think yes. So that is the one thing. The other thing I would like to mention about like on the coal overall, this thing is like, yes, renewables are doing a lot. People are investing a lot on the renewables and everything, which is good. But there is a lot of power requirements. Look at the India's power generation capacity. There's an increase. Yes. So whatever is increase is happening on the renewables, but the coal is not going anywhere. Coal is still growing at the rate of like 4.6% annually, and it will still keep growing up to 2025. So point is, yes, there may be a bit of downfall on the coal as a fuel, as a, any fossil fuel, but it will not be that prompt what the people are talking. So I think that's what I would like to say.
Yes, yes, correct. So now I come back to the Devendra Arulkarji. He's expert in India's business in the coal production side and develop the power plant. So Arulkarji, there the government has came out a lot of policies for, you know, improving the production. As of now, we have through 200 million metric ton, you know, kind of shortage. We, from last 10 years, 15 years, we are thinking that we will increase our production. And but still, we are not matching the demand. So I wanted to know what, you know, the government has did something on the auction of the coal mining and privatization in India. So what you see the next disruption in this area and impact on the business, you know, on the for the coal.
Yeah, thanks Viraji. Thanks for providing this opportunity to share my views as well as learn from co-panelists. I have been reading about Mr. Deepak Kannan in Platts, so this is the first time I am interacting with him. And Mr. Somani, of course, is an old hand with Singapore. And Atiji, we had interaction the other day. Before I come to your question on commercial mining or privatization or coal block auctioning, as variously it is being called, I would like to take the points which Mr. Somani made, a couple of points. The first is with respect to the primacy of coal in our energy basket. And he mentioned at a global level, something around 38% is the share of coal in electricity generation. In Indian context, it is 75% plus. Okay, more than 75% of our electricity is generated by coal. Add to that, the second largest source of electricity generation, gas, we don't have anything. We are literally zilch, okay. And coal we have thankfully in abundance as much as solar also. So that's one which is purely from the availability point of view. Input that we have in plenty and can be mined much, much cheaply than what it is being mined currently. This is the second point I want to make. You also mentioned about Germany, and we are being given to understand or brainwashed that Germany has eradicated coal or, you know, thrown coal out of window. But if you look at their energy basket, barely 7% comes from solar, 17% from wind, and 35% even now from coal and lignite. Okay, so despite this narrative or, you know, a lot of things what you hear, coal is not going anywhere. Even CEA's own report, okay, generation load balance report, from present 200 gigawatt capacity, installed capacity, by 2030, we are going to have 267 gigawatt despite the retirements. Okay, and I would consider this as a very conservative report because it doesn't take into account growing population of India and growing per capita consumption. Per capita consumption also is growing at about 4%, and population is growing at about 1.2, 1.3 kind of a percent. So both these. And if you have to match China of 2010 and 2030 of India, we should look up to China because we have comparable population. They are our neighbors, okay, despite the neighborly exchanges what we have now. There are certain things to be emulated. If you have to go to China of 2010, where they are close to 3,000 units per capita consumption against our 1181 currently, we need a capacity of close to 1,000 gigawatt. Okay, the last point on China. China has capped its coal capacity at 1,300 gigawatt, and as you rightly mentioned, world over, they are installing a lot of coal-based power plants, funding, financing, and doing all sorts of things. And we seem to have caught on this bug. I mean, as Mr. Arvind Subramaniam called it, carbon imperialism. As though we are the most advanced country of the world, like Western Europe or Scandinavian. Let us understand, we need power for our people, and it has to come from a cheaply, abundantly available resource like coal. Okay, that's my view. Now I move on to hope that buttresses the points what Mr. Somani made regarding the commercial mining. After half a century, after nationalizing the coal mines in mid-70s, it took us half a century to realize the perils of pure monopoly of government in coal mining as well as transportation. Transportation continues unfortunately, to again turn the wheel. And despite what we have been hearing about for last 10 years, finally on 29 September 2020, at the height of the COVID, this process was launched in the sense the bids were received. Okay, the process was launched much earlier prior to even onset of COVID, but finally the bids were received on 29th September 2020. So I can say the process has been rolled out and hope it is taken to its logical conclusion. A bit on the process, government hopes to auction about 200 coal blocks, out of which 41 were put in the initial list, but due to this, again, the love between state and center, finally the list was pruned down to 38. 278 documents were bought, but only 78 bids were received, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, 76 bids were received, 25% success rate. And out of 38 closed blocks which have been put for auction, only 19 blocks have valid bids, that is two bids or more. So those 19 blocks, we'll see the second round of bidding in terms of revenue share, which is the bid parameter. In terms of the question was that Dhiraj was alluding to, what will it do to the 200 million tons of thermal coal that we import? I think be clear and Deepakji will accept or admit, coking coal, we have no choice. It has to come from outside, and with the rapid scaling up of steel capacity that is planned, more and more coking coal will come. However, for thermal coal, what happens to this 200 million tons? Okay, if you look at challenges that are involved in developing the blocks or even building evacuation structure, which is not a very, you know, main challenge. These blocks will take 5 to 7 years to come into production, barring two, three which were in production and which were cancelled and which are being reallocated. So practically for the next 4 to 5 years, we continue as it is. If you look at CIL's record, 1 billion ton target has remained constant, but the date has already gone from 2019 to, I think probably they're talking about 2023, and be sure it will go to 2027. Last year we had 607, year before that we had similar number 606, 607. This year the expectation is it will be 580 or thereabout. So the imports, once this COVID impact is reduced and the power sector takes off, we are seeing that in October, the imports are again going to climb up. That is as far as the imports are concerned. With respect to replacement, even after 5 years, what is going to get replaced is only the 45 million tons of captive consumption, 45 as per the current level, and about 60 million tons of captive and 40 million tons of blending, the coal which is used for blending along with Indian coal. 45 million tons of imported coal-based plants coal has to remain there because they need that quality, otherwise boilers won't run. And people who, the sponge iron and cement industry using higher grade coal, next 4, 5 to 7 years, they have to keep on importing. That is the time horizon I'm seeing. In terms of Coal India competing with private sector, whether Coal India will be out-competed, answer is no, because Coal India starts with a very big advantage, okay, of having fantastic mega mines with very, very low stripping ratio, between 1 and 3, or even in cases less than 1, okay. And they are a well-entrenched player with depreciated infrastructure, evacuation infrastructure is in place in many places, though we are always critical of them. But they start with these two advantages, big advantages. So they will be there. Good private players also will coexist with that, because my belief is, like Mr. Somani said, the pie anyway is going to get expanded. It's not going to be as a doomsday scenario as people are making it out to be.
So now I think very much clear that coal definitely going to be there, and now we'll come back to the, you know, Deepak Kannanji. He's you know, from the pellets. Deepak, are you there?
Yes, I am here. Yes.
Okay. So Deepakji, being you are a global watcher to the particular coal. So what is the current production and consumption of thermal coal globally? And what is the impact of this, you know, rising tension between Australia and China? How the impact going to be there on the prices?
Yeah, first of all, thank you very much, Trade Reboot, for providing me this opportunity to be alongside all the big names in the industry. So it's an honor to be face to face with them. I would have loved to meet them face to face, but yeah, these are extraordinary times where we have to make do with laptop meetings now. But overall, I agree to most of the points the esteemed speakers have made, that coal is definitely here to stay. For one, that every country that produces coal has a lot of reserves. So if you have a lot of reserves and you don't make use of them, then it's a kind of a waste, right? And secondly, India, when it comes to India, I think India has been trying to like ramp up production to like kind of discourage all the state-owned utilities to stop importing and use domestic coal. But at one point of time, Coal India was producing like 9 to 10% year-on-year growth every year. But then we saw that Coal India had almost like 60 to 70 million of stockpiles lying at their ports, because it couldn't move the coal from the mine to the power plants. So, then the government decided, no, let's put it off to 24, 25 now. So those kind of scenarios we are definitely seeing, even when it comes to China. It's like it's producing like 3.5 billion metric tons of coal each year, and it's importing like 300 million thereabouts, including coking and thermal coal. So, When you compare India and China, India is like a genuine importer, because it definitely requires coal, because it is facing shortfalls in the domestic market. Unlike China, China is like an arbitrage player. So whenever domestic prices are very high, they go into the seaborne market. And globally, you can say the global seaborne trade is somewhere around 1 billion metric ton. And we don't expect it to change too soon, because as our esteemed speakers have said, that several countries are still continuing to produce coal, especially US. The US is producing coal, Colombia has coal, Russia, South Africa, Australia, everybody has coal, right? So all the eyes are now on Asia, because Asia is a big hotspot for coal markets, especially if you consider markets like Northeast Asia and Southeast Asia, where they don't have their own production. They are quite dependent on import. So many people are trying to get a piece of the pie in those markets, especially Southeast Asia, where you can say as much as the entire population of US doesn't have access to electricity in this part of the world, right? So that means to say your government's priority is to provide 24/7 electricity. And in those 5 years of Paris climate agreement, we have seen that there is a lot of talks about renewables, but we should always understand that renewables is starting from a very low base. So even if you add three power plants, it's like 100% growth, which is a wrong way to signify it, because it's very, very, very low base. Now I would agree with Mr. Arulkar sir as well, that India is like dependent on coal. Almost like 70% of it is produced from coal, and doesn't have gas of its own. I have spoken to people in Philippines. I have spoken to people in Japan. They all say, look, nuclear, when it comes to nuclear, it has its own challenges. We saw what happened earlier this decade in Japan. So many of the nuclear power plants are still not restarting. That means they have to depend on coal. And Philippines, they have gas-fired power plants, but there are depleting reserves at many of these producing regions. So that means they have to recontract, they have to enter into fresh contracts, and you never know whether they will be able to satisfy the entire demand. So we have an example which we saw a couple of years ago, when China said, we want to move away from coal and embrace LNG. And they did that for 3 months, and then they fell severely short of the power generation, because the winter was very, very colder than expected. So immediately in January, all of the Chinese came back into the market, started buying left, right and center. So you can't really make do with coal. And I have heard esteemed ministers in India speak about the coal usage. At one point of time, they were saying they are setting a huge target of 175 gigawatts of renewable power. And after 3-4 years, I heard the same minister say that now the talk is about base load fuel. So we need 24/7. If the sun doesn't shine, you don't have electricity. So what is the 24/7 electricity provider? That is thermal coal. And India has huge resources. So what do you do with that? There are gasification projects going on now. So trade flows may change a bit, but usage of coal is expected to remain somewhat significant in the foreseeable future. And on your second question, Dheeraji, that what is happening with China and Australia? Now, as I said, China itself is like producing 3.5 billion metric tons, and they're importing very negligible amount of thermal coal. So this negligible amount is having a huge impact on seaborne prices. They know that, right? And China, what China produces, the 5-5-NR cargo, Australia is also producing the same cargo. So if you have a competition, so which will you choose? You will definitely opt for domestic material, right? We haven't seen much disruptions in what is happening between China and Indonesia, because China doesn't produce what Indonesia produces. So Indonesian cargoes are still going in. But Australian, yes, there might be, the competition between the domestic and seaborne material. And this 170, 180 million of thermal coal what China imports, it's like a matter of days for them to produce that much and consume that much. So it's not a big thing. So whatever is in direct competition with them, they're trying to protect their own domestic industry, is my view.
Right. So now I move on the same things to, you know, as you rightly said, that in India, definitely there's a dependency of the coal going to be continued. Now, my question is to the Somani ji, till how long we are going to be continued and dependency on the coal? So do you see any future, the coal will be, be going to end and will completely transform into the alternate energy and any other sources? So Rajesh ji.
So Dheeraj ji, if you go the world book, the total coal reserves, which is top six countries have the 80% share, which includes the USA, Russia, Australia, China, and India. So the reserve wise, India plays very well. Next come to the production. India is second largest country of the coal producing in the world after the China. And fortunately, you can say the Indian government is thriving on to use these resources with full capacity. There can be debate whether they have achieved 1 billion or not billion, but definitely if you see the few year back, from 300 for 350 to now, it is almost they are touching to the 700 million ton coal. So there is a clear cut, you can say, that the swing as far as India is concerned in favor of the coal. As I told you earlier, that the main game changer will be the availability of renewable energy at the low cost. Otherwise, if you ask trend-wise also, the global energy mix definitely shifting towards the low carbon emission. It is a, you can say, regulatory requirement, or it is awareness of the responsible governments or the citizens, whatever way you think. There is a shift. But can this shift make the coal zero? That is not visible in the near future. Second important part we should not forget. The power is just such a, you can say, the utility, that even water you can accept 1 or 2 days no supply. But the electricity, your country cannot run 1 or 2 days. But at the same time, we should not forget the new technology can also improve the emission of the coal power plant. As per the study, if every 1% of the coal power plant efficiency is increased, it is going to reduce 2-3% of the CO2 emission. So there is an advantage of technological development not only against coal but in favor of coal also. And today, in case of the reliability, safety, cost effectiveness, coal is still stand tall, at least in Asian countries, which is by default already become the world manufacturing house. New power plants are under pipeline. India already made good assessment. And to give you the overall perspective, recently, the BP has made the new study of the mapping the future energy. And they have created a three scenario. By 2050, if the world has to achieve zero CO2 emission, there can be three approach. First is the rapid approach. By all means, hook and cook, or by putting any, you can say that regulatory framework, extra duty, carbon tax, you can achieve by 2050, do the rapid option. But still, the coal will be used 15%. The another scenario is the net zero. Suppose your ultimate aim is to go zero CO2 emission by 2050, then definitely you have still 7% coal to be used. Otherwise, nuclear, hydro, or renewable take place against the oil and natural gas. But if you go for third way, then this is a business as usual, which is right now. Like that, people are working on new technology, renewable energy's cost to be reduced, etc. The coal will be reduced only by 22%. So that means 78% coal is still going to be used by 2050, if business as usual. So, in fairness, I would like to say, yes, coal assets is, you can say, less preferred, and it is little late if anybody want to make the big investment. But at the same time, writing obituary for the coal is too early.
Okay, so the point is that the another big statement is still, you know, people are looking investment. Coal is the safe bet. You can invest it. Now coming to the Devendra Arulkarji, so you have Devendraji, you've seen the India market. We know that entire coastal belt is there. That's why because of the challenge in the transportation and movement of coals from the mines, and that is why we are having a coastal area. We continue. So what you see challenge, how the India can overcome from these challenges in transportation of the coal from the mining?
See, while the coal production can be scaled up because you operate in a limited geographical area, land acquisition issues are far less challenging compared to railways. The rail network is extremely difficult to put in place. And that's where the problem is. I came across some interesting numbers. In 1951, 65% of coal was moving on rail and balance 35% on road. And in 2019, when this figure, some eminent speaker shared at a conference, coal transit was, the ratio had exactly changed. 35% was moving on rail because the rail network had remained stagnant. And whatever coal had to be evacuated, because you can't idle the power plant, you can't idle your industry. So it was moving on roads. So that is a big, big challenge in these areas. Several last mile connectivity projects are in pipeline for last decades or so. Jharsuguda-Barpali, since 1992, we are seeing, and in 2018, one line was commissioned. Coal is moving on that in a small means because MCL did not ramp up their side of the loading system. Then we have in CCL, the two mega mines, Magadh, Amrapali, entire coal has to be evacuated by road. The very famous Torishippur line finally saw light of the day. However, the connection between the mines, these mega mines, and the sidings is not in place. There are a couple of villages in the vicinity, extremely hostile, and you are reading about what is happening in Pakri Barwadi also. And that situation is almost prevalent in entire Jharkhand and part of West Bengal, which is, having these kinds of ground problems. So again, no infrastructure. In terms of infrastructure, relatively, CCL has been a bit better and NCL definitely has been a bit better. So that is the challenge, is that mining areas have. Coming back to whether we are going to move away from road anytime soon, the answer is no, because all these rail lines, either the progress is slow or even if they are ready, connecting links in terms of conveyors and rapid loading system are not in place. So again, we are either you have this or you have that. You don't have both. Okay, so that is a big challenge. And that's where, again, I am quite optimistic on imported coal, because that is the need of the hour. And as Mr. Somani said, you can manage without water for 24 to 48 hours. You can't manage without electricity. And since a couple of us are from Mumbai, Dheeraj is smiling. Few hours shut down here in Mumbai tripping, and a whole everyone
lag was shut down.
okay. Fortunately, yes. For other parts of the country, barring these three, four
islands,
they don't have this problem, because otherwise also power is not available. So whether absence of power doesn't make a change or doesn't make a difference. Okay.
Right.
So now, the challenges are equally humongous. I would say even much more.
Correct. So,
Devendra, just would like to say, you say the Bombay power trip. So on lighter side, I can say that the COVID has stopped the tripping, but electricity is still continuing.
Yeah. See, electricity is on holidays in most part of the country, barring the islands served by, earlier BSES and Tata Power, and now thereafter the people who have taken over these companies, or CESC and AEC.
So next question to Atit. You are in the trading business, you are handling the coal from Asia Pacific market, and just wanted to know what is changed in the coal market. 10 years before, when you entered to the coal business, that time was, the time of the coal was a very demanding, and a few players were there. People were having monopolistic, way, and there was a lot of transparency issues were also there. And now, 10 years, a decade, entire decade, what gone change? And after the next 10 years, what going to change? What you perceive is a change in the coal market?
I think what has changed in the last 10 years, so when I joined the industry, the coal, right, pretty much I was in the international coal trading side. India used to import from China. So we used to buy cargoes from China. I bought from Swaniji as well at times, from So we used to import from China. Then slowly and gradually, India has looked at initially South Australia, then China, then it's been shifted to South Africa, and eventually by 2006, 2007 has gone to Indonesia. That guys, we need some coal, right? So it is gradually growing. Then 2006 or 7, when China started being a net importer, we really seen a big change in the complete change in the entire structure of the how the coal business is being done. I've seen Indonesian cargoes being from Asia, the whole coal used to to go all the way to Europe. So we also, myself, has supplied some cargo from Indonesia to European countries at times, right? Like I'm talking about like long time back. Now we see the complete change in the whole scenario, and which is like where we have seen a lot of Atlantic cargoes or the coal is being focusing into Asia. So like we see that like South Africa, the biggest market initially being the Europe, which is like the that's what like I've seen that has been slowly changed by India took over as the largest importer. It was still is India as the largest importer, but like Korea is also being a part of it. So like South African is going a lot to Korea. And like India, then like Europe is like almost nothing, I would say, from South Africa. So I've seen like a lot of change happening in the coal industry. How I see the future, okay, previously it was not too much of like there was a less amount of transparency because of the known technology and everything. So we have seen a lot of issues in terms of the qualities, and then like the each and every country has their own way of working, so Indonesia. But now things are getting much better because the industry is maturing. The each and every country has their proper rules and regulations with the help of technology as well. So that is going pretty good. After a few years, I see the transparency is been going more and more, is growing everywhere. So that really helps in terms of buying the right products and the right thing for all the markets. What I see as a change is like pretty much the markets is going to change, right? So I would say India is right now at the like either the largest importer of the world or the second largest. So between China and India, the first position always like keep changing. Japan used to be the main thing, but it's become a stagnant at the moment. We have seen the Southeast Asia market growing a lot. So the whole thing is all about like how the changes are happening. It's just the geography. Which geography will grow much faster in terms of the coal importers or the exporters kind of a thing is keep changing. And that's what I see. I would say that like next another 7-8 years is all about the India and Southeast Asia. So China, yes, it has been there. It is already there, but like they are pretty much self-reliant. Plus they are also importing at that terms. But I think the more reliability factor will be given by India as an importer as well as the Southeast Asia. So it's all about like changing the geography. And probably after 10 years, maybe you never know, Africa may be the real place where the whole things are really growing. So I would put it that way.
Right. So, you know, it's everything changing. You need, yes.
Dedaji, I would just like to add to Ati. You said the what changes taken place in the coal trade. I can say to you that the first when we, I'm talking about 94, 95, when first time we bring the coal in India, probably we were the among first who bring the coal in capesize vessel at Bagdala port. It was a midstream discharge port. And there was no single port in India who could have handled the capesize vessel. Today, now India is equipped with number of ports which can handle the capesize vessel, which has reduced the landing cost of the coal in the country.
Correct.
Second important change which has taken place, most of like the India and China, which are the largest importer of the coal, were heavily depend upon Indonesia, South Africa. Or sometime when the price arbitrage were taking place, Australia was also coming to India. But today, the coal book become global. If the US coal is viable, it is also taking place or coming to India. Colombia coal is coming. CIS coal is coming. So buyer has a more choice. Third important change, which Atita also touched, that transparency has increased a lot. Now, today, you know the price of South African index, Australian index. There was a lacking for the price transparency in the Indonesia. But now there is an Indonesian index is also there. So having such type of transparency, and top of that, the fastest communication system which we are now experiencing, in no time, you can send the photo of the coal available from the mine on your WhatsApp in no second. Earlier, the sample used to come, people used to look into, send to the laboratory, and then used to be finalized. So these are the major, you can say, handling changes and the transparency, which has made coal really more feasible commodity for the various countries to arbitrage with the local cost, domestic cost, as well as the imported cost.
Sir, you, as you rightly said, ki the last 10 decade, you know, one decade, you know, 10 years was on the transparencies, handling size, logistic man. What the future, you know, what you see the change in the terms of technology, in terms of the digitalization, being this is the digitalization Prime Minister Modi started Digital India. So what you see, whether we can impose in our current trading aspects, current processing aspects, current working aspects, what your thought on it?
Let us be specific about the digitalization. In my opinion, two segments are more relevant for the coal commodity. First is the artificial intelligence, which is AI. Why I am saying so? Because the artificial intelligence and application of it has improved the decision making of not only of the traders, but of the majority of the end user or mine owners also. Second important part, that by using the artificial intelligence, you are avoiding the human error, which sometimes landing you in a big trouble, whether on the wrong side of the call or not anticipating something which is behind the scene, which artificial intelligence by reading the behavior part can bring the real picture on surface. So this is the one thing. And to give you another example, today, now sugar trade at Chicago or an exchange, more than 30 or 40% sugar trades are being now squared by the machine by using the AI. So the human decision-making process has been supported by this meticulous data reading along with the behavioral part. Second is blockchain. The very, you can say, the useful application of blockchain cannot be more than for a commodity where they are connecting number of people from different locations. Banks are sitting somewhere in Geneva, traders are sitting in Singapore, Dubai, mine owners are in Australia or in South Africa, Indonesia, buyer is sitting in India or China. So one is that you can continue to work on the traditional flow of the documents, which take its own time, and have also inbuilt risk. Risk in the sense that documents, we have seen number of times in the volatile market, buyer or suppliers are taking advantage of the technical ground, like discrepancy in LC, discrepancy in documents, delay in submission of non-negotiable documents, etc. These all things can be removed in one shot by every stakeholder on the blockchain. No room for hiding or the bad intention. So this can be a great forum, provided you can collaborate and bring all these stakeholders together, which is the biggest challenge today for making the blockchain more useful, or rather I should say faster application of blockchain in the business.
Very rightly said by, you know, another statement, a new 10 years going to be on the technology, integration of the technology into your trade. Rightly mentioned by the Sumaniji, artificial intelligence and blockchain will pave the way of the traders in minimizing the cost and benefiting the cost benefit to the consumer. So that's the biggest example going to be there. And that is why this entire 3 days conference on the trade reboot side is on the technology and such already in the Western part, Western world is already built in, and now it has to become to the India and already there. Now on the last part, to the Deepak Anandji, Deepak, everyone, you know, we are full session unless it cannot finish about the trend in the market price. So, you know, people to a month and wanted to book the cargo in December, and sometimes till maybe 6 months, like, you know, Somanaji and Karab, you know, Atit always have a trend of, you know, 1 year cargo or 6 month cargo. Three people, what is the pricing strategy for them, and what your advice to the RP, what they should you know, book your cargo, book that their cargo, whether the downfall going to there, if downfall to there, the how they will, you know, have a risk mitigation scheme. Wanted to know from Deepak, global perspective.
Yes, so in the last 3 years, we have seen a lot of factors that have come into play. Earlier, it was just the supply demand fundamental, but right now, weather is playing a big role in terms of how it shapes, you know, structures the demand supply fundamentals. At one point of time, when China was in the market in 2017, there was heavy rains in Indonesia, labor strikes in Australia, labor strikes in Colombia, which reduced supplies very significantly, and we saw the result of that. The prices more than doubled. So to have such a similar effect, we need to have that perfect storm where we have China's influence, we have weather related constraints and the labor strikes as well, which is impacting the global supply. So those kind of things that we are not seeing at the moment. So China has big influence on the market. We have seen how their procurement strategy has changed. Earlier, they used to buy in Q4, but right now they start buying in Q3 itself. So slowly they come into the market, they restock, and then by the time they enter October, they have so much of stockpiles that they are in no hurry to buy. So when China is out, nobody else pushes up the price. So that's like quite a bearish point for you know, any expectations of any price increase in Q4. Having said that, if the winter is very harsh in China, then they will start buying quite a bit. So that means you will have positive support for prices. And now it's seasonally rainy season in Indonesia, that which has started in October. So we have heard that rains are disrupting vessel loading activities and production at very few mines, not everybody. So that means if it rains heavily, then we can see some production cuts there. That means that is a positive for the prices. And then the ongoing Colombian strikes there, South Africa is now more focused on its own domestic industry rather than export. So that leaves Australia. Australia again is, you know, there are a few major players who have strong control over the production. So that means, you know, that could also push up the price quite rapidly. So it depends on China first. Secondly, any weather related or God of, you know, hand of God, you know, activities that could push up the price this in the next 3 months. That's just my personal view.
So now the same view, which I would like to take it from the Atit.
I think I quietly agree with Deepak Bhai that what he said. Just few points I want to add over here is that you look at this currently, I'm relatively positive on the market. Because one is the winter, because winter is being like, and then this year, as per the weather forecast, is going to be harsher winter than the average one. So that is one kind of a forecast already we have it in our hand. There is a one La Nina being formed in the Pacific region. So when there's like in Pacific region has been formed, so we see a lot of rains and like the problems related to weather and the rain and everything in Indonesia and in the Kalimantan region as well as in Australia. So I think that will also disrupt the supplies in a big way. Australia to an extent when there's a really big flood, but like Indonesia, even the like a one day of rain really disrupt the hauling process and then the loading process and everything. So looking at that thing, I see that like market is going to be strong. Demand from China is definitely stronger. Looking at they're banning Australian cargoes. So like you can see that there's some region will be like definitely they can't import South African because of their trace element issues. Australia, they're trying to, again, we all know that like arm twisting is happening between China and Australia. So it's like, what will be the benefit? It's like, is Indonesian coal. And then same way, what I see, India is also kind of seasonally strong after monsoon. So like we have seen a good monsoon this year. And like end of September, October, we have seen a decent buying from India. And like I can see that sense that the India is still looking to, is still hungry and then looking to buy. So I'm quite positive for like next few months from the demand perspective as well as the supply tightness. And but the one thing I, as a point of caution, like to everyone, is that like coal industry and the prices has gone into kind of a scenario where like we have seen sudden up and sudden down moves, right? So like we have seen this market goes up by like at least 20-25% in like a week of time. And the same way it just falls down as well. It's the same way when the China pulls the plug. So that's all probably my view from the for the coal prices in the near future.
Yes. So now to Devendra Arunkarji, so what your perspective to the participants? Mute. Yeah.
Okay. With respect to pricing, I think what Deepakji and Atulji have mentioned makes eminent sense, because China is the major factor, and the way it is centrally controlled, that makes the factor even much more potent compared to, you know, the democracies of the world. Okay. And you can read between the lines there. I completely agree. Even the prices which are seen today are unviable for the producers and everyone in the chain, and somewhere they have to go to the realistic level where it is, so that they survive and the consumers to survive, and both depend on each other. I would like to, since the area also has been commercial mining, whether commercial mining will have any impact on this pricing or anything. My sense is in the next half a decade or so, no, because simply that much coal is not going to come in the market to influence this 200 million tons imports, okay, which thermal coal imports, which we are seeing. So the prices, barring those factors, will have to move in a fairly narrow range. I do hope they don't go to the 192 or even 100 plus levels, which actually hurts everyone in the process. Okay. So that's my take on the pricing.
We should also not forget that after COVID or impact of the COVID, every government or every economy is trying to bring back their economy as fast as possible on the normal speed or the faster recovery, which implies that they are going to provide extra support to the domestic economy, and that is going to consume more energy and more coal. Second important part is that today, if India and China want to grow, and which they have come back, according to me, very fast as far as the power generation is concerned, as far as coal production is concerned, both the countries are as good as normal days in today's scenario. So looking to that, I don't think there is any big downfall or concern about the coal. But yes, rider is there. The size of economic impact, suppose the COVID last month, something more, or there is a second or third wave so-called. And the speed of recovery from it in the main coal consuming countries, that will determine the ultimate size of the recovery or decline in the coal demand. But if you ask 2020, there is a overall in every sector, in every region, there is a 8% reduction in the coal demand and consumption, which is the largest after World War II. So this decline has taken place in 2020. So from here, it can be a better not the lower.
Great. Sir, my last question to you, sir, I'm also quite a watcher to this coal segment. I've seen a lot of players like traders, comes and goes. So what is the, why it is, people comes, immediately lose out the patience and already, gone out from the market. What is the reason and why this are happening? And second point also to you, sir, being a manufacturer like a miner and consumer, they are coming closely together. So will be future for the trader going to be there or no?
No, repeat your second question. What you said?
Sir, where the miners are closely coming together to the reaching to the consumer directly, will the Caraval like SIS Singapore, like any other company, those are having a coal trading business, how they will survive long?
You are coming to the first question about the longevity of the trading companies. On lighter side, I can say they are not hiring chartered accountant. But real thing is that, say in any commodity trading, it is the volatility and the risk management.
Correct.
These are the two major, you can say, the soft skill require any trader or trading company. Otherwise, I have been telling my team also and sharing them that the biggest risk in our trading business, commodity trading business, is not to take the risk. So without taking risk, you can't do the trade. But how you can manage it? How you can read the lining before it become news? That is more important. And don't forget, it is like any business. There is always race between greed and fear, and you have to ultimately balance it. And it is the expectation from trader that he should not only make money during the rising market, but he should make money in the down market also.
Correct.
True. So, company like good governance and value addition in mind, they can survive in all sort of the business.
Correct.
Let me tell you, without adding any value, it is difficult for any trading company to remain in the chain of the chain supply. So what value you are adding for the mine owners and what value you are adding for your customer, this is the relevant question which any trading company should keep asking ourselves.
Perfect.
And second important part, even if you are doing so, don't forget there is a very low trade barrier. You are going to be copied by others also. So you need to continuously innovate yourself with the business model, with the additional service. Then only you can survive in the market. I can tell you, in India, which mine owners is not supplying coal directly? Whether it's a Glencore, whether BHP Billiton, Anglo, any name you take it, they are all sitting in the heart of the Indian market. But still, Indian traders or the international trading companies are adding value by way of taking bigger coal, bringing capsize vessel, giving to small buyers. So there are various way how you can add value into it. So the so long you are ready, you are convinced and ready to answer that you are adding value into the. But I have seen some of the traders come with the idea of making quick money, like exchange is giving coal price $70 and you feel it is the cheapest and buy 10 cargo, 5 cargos, and then you find all of a sudden there is a 2000, after 2008 there is a 2009 also. So then you are lost into the speculation. So the trade and speculation are although close, but there is a very thin divider. If you don't follow that divider, your trading can go haywire.
Yes, sir. So there's a lot of things to be discussed. A lot of queries also coming, but due to the paucity of time, we had another session. We need to wind out. Just wanted to give the highlight of the today's session. Everyone said that the market is growing market. The going to be remaining the foray. Always be on the trading side. Don't lose out patience. And Deepak and both have said that market is bullish. Quarter three and quarter four are bullish. And rightly mentioned by the Somaniji, well, required in the trading business. Innovation and digitalization is required in the business. Very rightly by the Aurangka ji, even though supply chain system is going to be robust and we need to have an import continue going to be there. So with this, I really thankful to all the four panelists over here for excellent project time out. I request to don't quit from here because there's a media bite going to be there. So we remain here. We'll out from the from this stage. We'll be backstage. Now the next new stage or new session going to be there. So very thankful to all the panelists over here. Ati ji, Deepak ji, Rajesh ji, and Devendra ji. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dhiraj ji, and all of you, Devendra, Ati, and Deepak. Nice
thank
to
see all of you.
Let us be in touch.
Yeah, virtually, physically.
Have a great time ahead and happy Diwali.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, don't shoot the platform. We are media white going to be there, sir.
Okay, sure.
Sorry, what did you say?
Don't quit the platform. Be just there.
Media bites will be there. Media interview will be there. So don't quit. Now next.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, Saloni.
Good evening. So we'll just wait for everyone to join us. Good evening. Good evening. We're just waiting for everyone to join us.
Good evening,
us.
Lama.
Sure.
Yeah.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Good evening, Ajay. And sorry for the delay. This session, the earlier session was, got delayed. Good evening, Jillian.
Hello.
Good evening.
Hi, everyone.
Good evening.
Yeah, hi. So,
Yes, we're just waiting for Catherine to join us. While I think she's a part of it, I don't know why she's not on screen, though. Yes. Hi.
You can start.
Everyone on stage can hear me. Is it okay?
Yeah.
So I think we're good to start. Before starting, would like to address the audience that good evening. I'm Saloni Maria Kothari. I'm the CEO of Metalex. I'm going to be the moderator for this session. The topic which we're discussing today is the impact of technological innovation on the future of B2B and corporate banking. Before we start, I would just like to let you know if you have any questions based on our discussion today or if you want some answers regarding this, please leave your questions on the Q&A section on the right-hand side of the screen which you see, and we'll be happy to answer them to the best of our abilities. Before we start, just a small summary of what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about the B2B banking, the new changes in the future, how do we see it going ahead, the blockchain, how do we talk about digitalization, and the digital currencies which are going to be coming into play. So before I start, I would take this time to just introduce all our panel members, and then we can begin our discussion. First, we have Ms. Catherine Strachan. She's the Managing Director and Head of Copy at Copy House Limited, a content marketing agency specializing in technology and fintech content. Some of her globally renowned clients include Klarna, Travelex, Cigna, and Lloyds Bank. When she's not managing her team, Catherine runs several SEO copywriting workshops and training courses, including the acclaimed 11-week Ultimate SEO and Copyright course. Next, we have Ms. Jillian Goodsell, and she's the Editor-in-Chief and Founder of Block Leaders. She freelances for the Irish Tech News, the Irish Central, Irish Independent, and the Irish Times. In June, Jillian was awarded the 2020 Blockchain Journalist by Uptrends, which is the largest blockchain social platform. She's an advisor to several ICOs, has been named a crypto queen by InZero conferences, as well as listed in the 50 most influential women in the global blockchain roll call. She was awarded the Order of Merit by the president of Liberland. Next, we have Mr. Daryl Tan. He's the director, ABN AMRO Bank. He has worked with the ABN AMRO since 2012 and heads the transportation and logistics franchise for the ABN AMRO in Asia Pacific. He has more than 18 years of experience in both shipping and finance. Having clients across Asia, he has concluded transactions in Southeast Asia, Taiwan, Korea, India, Japan, and Hong Kong. So, yeah. Then we have Ms. Lana Abdulyawa. I'm sorry, please correct me if I pronounce your name wrong.
It's good enough.
Okay. She's an independent speaker and strategic advisor, digital strategy, innovation, and transformation. She's an experienced board-level advisor and mentor with a unique vantage point on how FS evolve in the digital age. Scientist by education, strategist by experience, visionary, she has the privilege to work with well-known international companies from various markets across the globe. Lastly, we have our panel member, CA Ajay Kumar. He's a Tate Finance professional, ACA, ACWA, a CFA, MBA, and ACMA. He's the current chairperson of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, the UK chapter. He's a senior leader and trade finance professional with one of the biggest interbank based in London. He has worked in four countries and with three of the biggest banks with more than 20 years of experience in trade finance, in addition to the Indian FI SIDBI. That's a small introduction of everyone we have with us today. And before we start, I would just like to say, getting into details, if anyone has an opening statement they would like to address to the audience, or would they like to say something, if I've missed anything, please go ahead. Anyone? No? Okay. So let's start with Mr. CA Ajay Kumar. What are your thoughts on the B2B banking and the digital banking, which is air around today? If you can have your views on that. Mr. Ajay, can you hear me? Can you hear me, Mr. Ajay? I think your mic is off. Your mic is off. If you put it on, we'll be able to hear you.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you now.
Hello.
Yes. Yeah, we can hear you. I'm sorry, Mr. Ajay, are you there? Can you hear us? Okay. Till we get connection back with Mr. Ajay, let's start with Ms. Jillian. So let's talk about digital currencies, cryptocurrencies.
Hello, can you hear me?
How does it? Okay. Sorry. I'm sorry. Yes. Mr. Ajay, are you there? Can you hear us?
Anyone can hear me?
We all can hear you.
You can hear me. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Mr. Ajay, are we starting
okay,
with you?
Somebody asked something to me.
Yes, can we start with you? What we wanted to know was what is your views on the B2B banking?
Hello.
Okay, I'm really sorry about this technical issue. We can hear you. Okay, till Mr. Ajay comes back, let's talk to Ms. Julian. Let's talk about digital currency. What is with crypto?